بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين. Ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests, and welcome friends, good evening. دار الآثار الإسلامية welcomes you this evening to the second lecture of the season and is happy to see the return of old friends as well as the new faces in the audience. Tonight, before we start, I would like to thank everyone in the audience for their courteous consideration for turning off their mobiles and their pages. Now, two more announcements, if I may. Tomorrow night is jazz night at 7 o'clock, as usual our time. And Wednesday is Ibn Battuta night, again at 7 o'clock. Please make your reservations ahead of time. Now, on tonight's lecture, there are several similarities between last week's lecture and tonight's lecture, except that I won't be talking for so long. I know that tonight's speaker, Professor Abdullah Al-Tayyib, no longer requires an introduction, since like Professor Farivari, he has spoken several times before at Dar al-Athar al-Islamiyya. Not only did he deliver last week's lecture, but I also remember him, sorry, not only did he deliver a lecture last year, but I remember him participating in our program at the early days of the Dar, before the Iraqi invasion, when he was a professor of Arabic at Kuwait University. At that time, Dar al-Athar al-Islamiyya, the lectures were given at the newly refurbished auditorium at the National Museum Complex. Both lecturers, that is last week's lecture and this week's, and tonight's lecture, that is, deal with the history of the land and the Nile, along the Nile. Last week, Professor Farivari dealt with the subject in Nubia, and tonight we shall be moving a little further south, the land of the Sudan, where Professor Al-Tayyib delivered his lecture on the survey of the traditional learnings in Sudan. As I said, I will not be taking so long. I know you are eager to listen to Professor Al-Tayyib, so without any delay, ladies and gentlemen, Professor Abdullah Al-Tayyib.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. Well, it is not very easy for me to speak in English because it is not my language and it is not my line either. Arabic is my line. But anyway, my talk is going to be really not about any place south of Nubia, but it is about the Sudan of the Fundi area, which used to stretch from Aswan to, I've got a map here, used to stretch from south from here, part of Upper Egypt, to about here, latitude just before latitude 12. Now, later on, boundary was moved to the second cataract here. But still, the people north of it, that is Nubia, paid allegiance to the king of Sinai, so that a traveler, a Turkish traveler, traveling later on, as he parted from Aswan, he wrote, "Huna tabtadi Fundustan," from this place onward, Fundustan means. Well, I really am not talking about going to talk about the history or about the geography of the place. I want to speak about the traditional learning in the Sudan, the traditional life in the Sudan, and how that has been affected or influenced and changed by modern education and contact with more powerful people conquering the Sudan during the last century and during this century, by force of arms, and then by force of industrial and scientific superiority. Well, Sudan education in the Sudan was based on an institution called Al-Khalwa. Al-Khalwa is derived from the word khala. When you say khala, khala to be empty. Khala, the wilderness. Khalwa is really seeking seclusion in the wilderness. That is what hermits used to do. Or in a secluded place, like a cave. Or in a built-up place. But then, it came to denote only the place for learning the Quran and for learning religious studies. Then the place when the learning and the religious studies and the school and so on were not there was used as a guest house. In every village, there is a place called Al-Khalwa. Hopefully people hope it will be one day a school of the Quran and a school of teaching religion. But because there are villagers and not able to do that, let it be a place where hospitality can be offered to passers-by, itinerant workers, and so on and so forth. In every Sudanese village, there is a khalwa, either meaning a school or meaning a guest house. So much for the khalwa. Now to what is taught in the khalwa. Quran and ilm and science. These were the subjects taught in the khalwa. Science here means the study of religious law, rituals, the traditions of the Prophet Hadith, and the ideas derived from them. When I was a schoolboy, we used to be asked, what are you studying? Are you studying ilm or Quran? Our answer, no. We study some Quran, we study some religion, but also we study English and arithmetic, geography, and all these other subjects. Then people say, you are wasting your time. You are not studying ilm or Quran. That is, you are now following the unbelievers. You are following the way of the world. You are not following the way of tradition. I used to puzzle what they meant, what did they mean by ilm? Ilm is science, knowledge. I think that they were right. Later on, it dawned upon me that the study of religious law and right and all religious knowledge meant that they had to do some work which would be called science. For example, in order to ensure that the taste of water and the color of water have not been changed, you have to study something about chemistry and about biology and so on. There was no biology and no chemistry in the sense we know that now, but they had to do a lot of experimentation and find out what would change the color of water, really change the color of water. For example, if the color of water changes just because it is running on a course that has salt in it, it has not changed. So they have to study what is natural change, what is artificial change, and thereby over the years, Muslims developed chemistry, astronomy, physics, quite a number of the rudiments of the modern sciences that began by the Muslim scholars of old. This is very important because once we realize that people based their learning on the Quran, they studied the meaning of the words, the grammar of the words, the sound. That, of course, made them study something about sound, about linguistics and so on. So much so that some of the scholars now think that the modern linguistics began only after the book of Sibawayh was translated towards the end of the last century by a German called Jahn, having already been published by a Frenchman called Derrida. Now, I don't want to speak about these things which are more connected with my everyday study and so on. I would like to move now to the question of the Kharwa. The Kharwa, as I said to you, was taught the Quran and taught religious studies. Now, where were these things taught? These were taught in this country, the Sudan. But were only taught after Islam came into the Sudan. When did Islam come into the Sudan? According to many historians, like Professor Makisi Beka, like Professor Yusuf Fadl, like Dr. Abdul Majid Abdin, and many others, even Noam Shuger, Noam Beshugur, and Shuger, who wrote the history of the Sudan, people are inclined that traders infiltrated into the Sudan and introduced the beginnings of Islam there. And then the Mamluks of Egypt were hard on the Bedouins in Egypt. The Bedouins who had come from Arabia, you see, and so the Bedouins migrated to the Sudan. This is generally accepted. But it is to be questioned. First, because passage from Egypt to the Sudan is very difficult because of the cataracts of the Nile. And the valley is very narrow. And the inhabitants of the area between Aswan and the fourth cataract here, the river is navigable from here onwards now. The passage is very difficult. And one would doubt that whether that was the course which Islam has taken for coming into the Sudan. But because people want everything to come from Egypt into the Sudan, they are inclined to think that Islam came into the Sudan through Egypt. I think last year, in my talk here, I tried to understand that the first immigration from Arabia during the life of the Prophet himself upon him was to this part of the western coast of the Red Sea called Abyssinia in those days than to Sumerian Abyssinia. Now, I would like to say, and now people are inclined to think, like people who know and what is studying it, are inclined to think that way. And I think that Islam spread in the Sudan over a very long period, but from very early times. I cite as a proof for that, as just one. Yazid ibn Abi Habib was one of the most foremost scholars of early Islam, especially in the field of fiqh, that is, knowledge of religious studies. He became prominent in Damascus and taught al-Awza'i, who was one of the beginners of the schools of jurisprudence and religious studies in the world of Islam in Java. Awza'i's system was later on ousted by the system of Malik, which prevails in the Sudan, in Africa, and I think the law in this country here is Malik. Now, Yazid ibn Abi Habib was a man of Dongola. And according to his own biography, he left Dongola and went to Fustat, that's Cairo. And in Fustat, he found people more inclined towards the Alim line, the Shia line. And he argued against it in favor of the Osman line, the Umayyad line. And of course, he ended in Damascus, the capital of the Umayyads, and became very prominent there. So, if you can just see from this that Yazid ibn Abi Habib must have studied in an Islamic seminary in Dongola or south of Dongola before going to Egypt. This witnesses that Islamic studies were in the Sudan long before the time when generally inclined to think they took place there. Now, the area of the northern Sudan used to be Christian, especially the region of Dongola. And because they were separated from the source of their Christianity, namely the Catholics of Rome and the Markites of Constantinople, they gradually lost contact with these sources, and Christianity started to be to disappear. When Ibn Jaber visited Dongola later on, around about the 11th or 12th century, he found little Christianity there. Here, in this place, here, called Dara, Hasaya, there was a cathedral, an Orthodox cathedral. Still the remains of it can be seen. But the people living in the very area where the cathedral stands, their ancestor was called Sha'adin. Sha'adin means spread the religion. So it means that Islam took place there, and this Sha'adin and his brother Abdul'al spread Islam in that area. According to one of the teachers, of the late teachers in that area, called Abdullah Nagar, who died in 1935, aged 95, he was asked, did teaching in this area begin after the Fu dynasty or before? He said, I think long before. A historian called Crawford, who wrote about the Fu kingdom of Sinan, thought he was wrong, because Daman was instituted by a man called Hamad bin Abdullah, and that appeared to have taken place during the 16th or the beginning of the 17th century. But Crawford is wrong, because the man, this Abdullah Nagar, traced the origin not to Hamad bin Abdullah, but to Hasaya, where Sha'adin started his Islamic school after the decadence of Christianity there. Islam did not start as a strong, powerful thing with Christianity being strong there. Although Christianity was not very strong north of Khartoum, it was strong south of Egypt, in Nubia, and it was strong on the Blue Nile in the Jazeera area between the two Niles. But in this area, north of it, there were places where there was Christianity there. Now, according to Tabakat, this is a work written by a man of 16th century who tried to write about the saints in the area. The first teachers of Orthodox Islam were the children of Jabir. There were four men, Abdurrahim, Abdurrahman, Osman, and Ibrahim, their eldest, called Ibrahim al-Ghulad, Ibrahim the chief. And the fifth was their sister, Fatima. They were very well versed in Maliki law. How did Maliki law come into the Sudan? According to Tabakat, it came with this one. But this is wrong. Maliki law must have been preceded by a long period of something taken from this school, taken from that school, and still affected by previous beliefs, Christian beliefs, pagan beliefs, even monotheistic beliefs, pre-Christianity and pre-Islam. Because there is evidence that there was monotheism in this area, which is called the island of Marawi. There is evidence of monotheism in this area, and one place here called Khatwa. Yeah. There is a rock with the traces of a foot on it, of a foot on it. And the legend there is that God wanted to build the Kaaba there, then changed his mind. And there is another story there that the prophet came with his bride there and wanted to be sent, but women did urination over there. The Murad, being an angel, took the prophet up. But is this prophet will be going to Jerusalem from Mecca, he did not need to go all this way, westward, north, that way, river, and then back. See, this is done by some of the airways now, but it's not. It couldn't have been done by a flying angel. You see, we really do not know how long it took for Islam, to spread in the area, and how it was brought about. But the four children of Jabir first settled here. And their sister came here to this area and founded a school there in a place called Gozer Kutra. It is here in this place. Still, you find a gumba, that is, a dome, built over the tomb of one of her descendants called the Sheikh Sayyid, mentioned in Mutabakat. And one of his descendants is one of the most prominent engineers in the Sudan, teaching in the faculty of engineering in the University of Khartoum. Now, these men taught Risala and Khalil. Khalil is the standard work on Maliki law. It is an abridged version of all the law. You learn it by heart, and then you learn the commentaries, which may run into 20 volumes or something like that. And Risala is a shorter version. And there are many other textbooks, but very important to learn Khalil and Risala, one of them. And if you know Khalil by heart, you are really a learned person. And they say that Fatima knew Khalil by heart. Now, another spreader of religious teaching in the Sudan was Tajuddin al-Din al-Bahari. But he taught a different version of Islam. He taught what we call esoteric Islam, Sufi Islam. Islam directed towards improving the spiritual teaching and the spiritual life of the individual. The kings of Sinan at that time thought that he was an agent of some Shia'ite sect. They were not very pleased with his coming. But that is why he modified his teaching and concentrated on the Qadiriyya Tariqah. So according to many historians, the Qadiriyya Tariqah was the first to enter the Sudan. But there is strong tradition that the Shadaliyya Tariqah entered the Sudan before the Qadiriyya Tariqah at the hands of a descendant of the Prophet, a man who claimed was a descendant of the Prophet. And this is general throughout the Muslim world. People claim that they are, and there may be real descendants of the Prophet, but I think the Queen of England, in her official biography, she is a descendant of the Prophet. Descended, I think, the Duke of Saxe-Coburg, I think, had a grandmother or something. Some Spanish descent, and that Spanish descent was linked with a family descended from the Prophet called Bani Hamud. And I think that is mentioned in one of the official biographies of the Queen. It is very strange that in the Sudan, some of the old people there said these English people are very noble people. They are descended from the Prophet. We had that long before I read the biography. I think I read the book about 10 years ago, something like that. Now, this man called Sharif Abu Dunan. The word Dunana itself means female wasp. But I don't think you can distinguish a male wasp from a female wasp. So I am inclined to think that Dunana here is a corruption of Zunana. And that means his nose was dripping all the time. And this is probable because you see he was an errant, pious man, and he did not care about the world. But it seems that he had many daughters, and he married them off, but people wanted to have some legacy descended from the Prophet. He said to have brought the Sudan Tariqa Shadali. Now, I explained something about the word khalwa. Now, the teacher in the khalwa is called the faqih. Faqih is a corruption of the word faqih. Person who knows fiqh, that is the study of the traditions of the Prophet and of Islamic law and of Islamic rights and teaching. The word is faqih, it makes shorting like that, but the plural is fugara. Fugara is not the plural of faqih, it is the plural of faqir, poor man. But learned men in matters of religion and Quran are called fugara because the first companions of the Prophet were made poor by the strong men of Mecca, and so they had to abandon both abode and wealth and go to Medina. And they were referred to in the Quran, لِلْفُقَرَاءِ الْمُهَاجِرِينَ. And so later on, people who were learned in religion were called fuqara. In hope that they would have the barakah or the blessing of the early companions of the Prophet. And up to this day, in West Africa, the students of the Quran and religion are called Muhajirin. And this seems to have been a very old appellation of students of the Quran and so on, but has disappeared in many of the Eastern countries. Still exists in West Africa. And in one of the commentaries on the grammar book, Tafsir Wahidi, you read, I met a group of Muhajirin, of immigrants, who taught me three similar letters. And then they wrote on the ground, of course, the letters of the alphabet. And they said to me, learn about the S, and about the A, and about the Sad, and about the Qaf. فَأَيْتُ أَتَيْتُ مُهَاجِرِينَ فَعَلَّمُونِي ثَلَاثَةَ أَحْرُفٍ مُتَشَابِهَاتٍ وَخَطُّوا لِي أَبْجَادٍ وَقَالُوا تَعَلَّمْ صَعْفَصًا وَقُرَيْشِيَاتٍ. So, you have the word fukara means religious men. The fukara were specialized in teaching the Quran and the other teachings. But then, after the coming of Tajuddin al-Din al-Bahari, Abu Dunan, and probably before that, there are people who say they met the Prophet in a vision and he gave them all the learning. And this would turn into big saints and would teach people many ways, many good about doing good works and so on, and they can cure the sick and so on. One of these people was Idris Wadal Akbar. His tomb is still to be found in a place called Elephone, very near Khartoum. He was the son of one of the daughters of Abu Dunana, or one of his descendants. And so the blessing, going back to the Prophet, came to him. And he saw the Prophet in a vision, and the Prophet gave him a lot of learning and a lot of blessing, and he was very influential in his time.
But I asked one of the people of the area to find out why the sellers of beer, native beer, Melissa, call on him. They say, Ya Fattah al-Bab, O God who opened the door of provisions, Ya Idris al-Bab, then they call for the help of Idris al-Bab, Ya Sid al-Fadda wal-Badda, that is, you are the master of flour and the increase of flour. Now this sort of incantation of prayer must have come from an older time. Another faqih called Hassan ibn Husuna, they attribute to him that a girl afraid of female circumcision ran to his place and he gave her shelter. And in the morning she went whole and perfect and healthy and completely circumcised. And people say, Ya Hassan wa Husuna, as-sabah al-bibba Husuna. Hassan wa Husuna attributed to her, called the dead Tobias. He was very wealthy. And also, like modern doctors, he charged a lot for curing those who were very ill. Tabaqat relates that a woman came to him with a very sick daughter and he asked her to give him an ounce of gold, and she did. And one of the students grumbled and said, look at this man collecting gold from here and there and give us a very poor diet to eat and reading the Quran in a broken way and leading us in prayers. And he overheard him and he said to him, yes, I read the Quran in a broken way. I don't know any grammar. You know all the grammar, and you know all the readings of the Quran. But God said, He accepts my reading, not yours. Now, this sort of antagonism between the proper scholars of Muslim studies and also the proper scholars who take their learning from a vision of the Prophet and the vision of past saints, you see, this antagonism continued for some time. But later, there was some sort of compromise. And